Can you believe that these beautiful gardens are known as the Bog Fields? Despite their unappealing name, they have a pretty special claim to fame. Do any thoughts spring to mind? Find out where I am in just a moment. Today's escapees are looking for a sociable spot in the country.
I can picture this, lots of friends, visitors, all sitting around. I can see how that would work, yeah.
But with business plans involving several cats, outbuildings also figure in their dream property.
Oh, wow, this would be great for the cattery.
Yeah, fantastic.
But will the outside space be more than they bargained for?
Cast your eyes as far as you can see into the distance. Because there's also 30 acres of additional land. You're stunned, aren't you?
Yeah.
Today, I'm in North Yorkshire, and these are the Valley Gardens in Harrogate, home to a large proportion of the town's 88 mineral springs, meaning that this prosperous spa town has more of them than anywhere else in the world. It all came about in 1571 when a William Slingsby discovered the health properties of this local water, having visited Spa in Belgium. Realising the business potential, he had a spring walled and paved, and soon enough visitors were flocking to the area to take the waters for medicinal purposes. But that's not the only reason visitors come to this beautiful county. The historic county of Yorkshire in the north of England is now recognised by its subdivided areas, including North Yorkshire and West Yorkshire. The region is half the size of Belgium and has its own dialect, as well as two national parks. The North York Moors gained national park status in 1952. Its 554 square miles feature vast areas of moorland plateau, as well as one of the largest concentrations of ancient trees in northern England. The Yorkshire Dales became the county's second national park in 1954. Most of the dales or valleys are named after the stream running through them. The curved limestone formation of Malham Cove was created by a waterfall at the end of the last ice age, over 12,000 years ago. Stone also features heavily in the man-made environment. Many pretty villages and market towns feature York stone, a building material that has been quarried since medieval times. So across moors and down dales, for those looking to experience stunning landscapes steeped in centuries of history, the Yorkshire countryside is certainly a place to head to. The average cost of a detached property in North Yorkshire is just under £310,000, some £16,000 below the national figure. However, as we know, it's a vast county and prices vary. The borough of Harrogate, for example, carries a premium of around 40%. But the neighbouring districts of Hambleton and Rydale still offer great access to the North York Moors and the Hawardian Hills, but they are more affordable, which is great news for today's buyers. Chris and Vicky from Prestbury, Cheshire, first met when they were teenagers.
Vicky and I met at high school. We were a blind date, and we've been together ever since. Right through university, Vicky's nursing training, marriage, and here we are 33 years on.
Chris works as a management consultant and Vicky is a project manager for a data company. But now their two children are grown up, they're looking towards retirement, and the time is right to get back to their roots.
We want to move to Yorkshire because it's actually where we're from originally, and we love the area. We live in a nice town now, but we want to be in a smaller village, have more privacy.
And Vicky has one specific dream in mind.
When I move to Yorkshire, the thing I'm looking forward to mostly is developing my own business. I'd love to run a cattery, and this should give me the opportunity to do so.
Ever since we've been together, we've had cats, and today we have three, two sisters and one feral cat that's adopted us, and they're going to enjoy the move as much as we are.
They're also hoping more rural surroundings will allow them to enjoy some hobbies too.
I love walking, we go cycling, I'm a very keen gardener. And when we go to Yorkshire, I just want to do more of those things.
I like cooking and I like to grow produce that I can actually turn into something in the kitchen. So I enjoy doing chutneys, pies and things like that.
But most of all, this move is about taking what feels like the next natural step in their life together.
Returning back to Yorkshire for us is a dream come true. Our life has been spent moving around and we feel like this is our final move because we've always wanted to go back.
Yeah.
Vicky and Chris want to focus their property search in the countryside north of York, and they particularly like the Hawardian Hills area of outstanding natural beauty. But before I start showing them houses, we're meeting on Yorkshire soil to discuss what they want from the move.
I mean, from just standing here looking around, it's fairly obvious why you want to move here. It's beautiful,
isn't it?
It's beautiful,
isn't it? Absolutely. Yeah.
Of all the places we've been, Yorkshire still feels like home. So it's a little bit of a homecoming, really.
So why is the time right for you to make this move now?
The children have grown up and left home, and the house is a little bit too big for us now, back in Cheshire. So it's a really good time to make that break.
OK, so let's get started. Let's talk about the house that you'd like to find up here. What do you have in mind from it? Talk me through it.
We love open plan, lots of light. We like traditional builds, though, so we're not really that interested in something ultra-modern.
The children are... Rachel's in Barnsley and Tom's going down south, but we'd like to keep a bedroom for them when they return home, and also a bedroom for guests. We've got friends and family that come to visit. So
I'm up to four bedrooms.
Four bedrooms. So, yeah, four or five, okay. But four minimum.
Anything else on the wish list?
A nice big kitchen. Ideally, yeah. I'd love a nice big kitchen and views. Views would be the icing on the cake, really, wouldn't it?
Absolutely. Views would be great. I want lots of space for a kitchen garden. And out in the country, of course, perhaps not completely in the middle of nowhere, maybe, close to a village, walking distance to the pub may be a good idea.
I think it'd be really nice to get involved in the community, get to know the locals.
So in terms of the cattery, what are you going to need from that?
The cattery is a big part. It's something that I've wanted to do for many years, and we've been researching it, and Chris has done a business plan which we've been tweaking over the last couple of years. So if we had outbuildings that we could convert into a cattery, that would be good.
OK, so you need outbuildings or you need land, presumably, on
That's
which
right.
to build something.
Yeah.
OK. So you're prepared to do work to get the cattery up and running. What about the house itself? Are you up for doing some work on a house?
We've changed many houses that we've had, so that's not a daunting prospect at all.
So, come on then, what's the budget that we're working with for this one?
We have a budget of £700,000 to £800,000. We may push that to £850,000 if you absolutely wow us with a place.
OK, no pressure then. But it's a great budget for this part of Yorkshire, and you'll be pleased to hear we've got some lovely properties to show you.
Great.
So, are you excited?
Yeah.
Very excited. To go?
Let's go.
Come on.
Vicky and Chris are prepared to stretch to £850,000 for the right property. They want a large kitchen and a minimum of four bedrooms. Ideally, the house would come with 2 to 3 acres of land, and they need outbuildings or the potential to build them for Vicky to create her cattery business. They'd like to be in close proximity to a village community with a pub in walking distance, and views would be a real bonus. With that wish list in mind, we've picked a great selection of houses to show them. And after each viewing, we'll be seeing how close they can get to guessing the asking price. Finally, we'll add a twist to their search with our mystery house, where it may be a case of last but not least. Our property search is taking us to the village of Bishop Thornton. A short drive away is Ripley. In the Middle Ages, the village was destroyed by the plague, but was largely rebuilt in the 1800s in the style of a French village, still characterised by cobbled squares and stone houses. Just under 3 miles away, back on the outskirts of Bishop Thornton, is the house that we've come to see.
Oh, that's a good smile. So, here we are. Let's just settle here and take a look.
Yeah, I like the stone build.
I like the driveway, the way it sweeps around. I like the look of the house, natural stone.
We would prefer to be more set back from a road. but we'll see.
OK.
We'll see.
Let's get started and let's take a look around the house. The original part of this property dates to around 1870, but an extension was added two decades ago, creating an L-shaped layout. Passing through the hall takes us into the largest of the reception rooms.
A lovely cosy lounge, got an open fireplace, feature fireplace.
Yeah, this is nice.
Very nice.
Windows on both sides, I like that very much.
A nice size room, it's not too big, not too small. I'm sure you can spend some nice evenings in here.
I'm just trying to visualise where my furniture will go. So until I've seen the rest of the house, I won't quite know how it fits. But I love this room. This is very nice.
Okay.
Yeah, agreed.
Well, there is quite a lot more to see in this house, and heading back through the hallway, we pass a handy cloakroom to reach the welcoming kitchen, which delivers a real country feel.
So come on into the kitchen, and there's a prize for anyone who spots the fantastic theme in the room.
Chickens.
And again, it's in the new part of the house, but what the owners have done is really got the character in here. So they've got a hand-built wooden kitchen, they've got reclaimed beams that they've brought in to give it that character. So it's just got that lovely farmhouse kitchen feel.
Yeah, it does. So it's very nice.
It is lovely. Again, you've got the dual aspect with the windows, which I like.
Nice room, perhaps a little smaller than I would have imagined.
There is a good-sized utility room through there, and if you've really been looking, you'll have noticed my Red Riding Hood basket of apples there that came from the orchard in the garden.
Oh, lovely.
Oh, how nice.
Yeah, lots of
chutney-making opportunities.
Vicky, in particular, seems charmed so far. And leading through into the original part of the home, we find a dedicated dining room.
Perfect. Perfect size. Perfect dining room. Could just imagine the family here at Christmas. It's really lovely, isn't it?
Yeah, couldn't agree more. Lovely.
Really nice.
And then through there, you've got a snug with another lovely open fireplace, and beyond that, a conservatory. There is space to spread out definitely in the house.
I like it.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. I like it very much.
With fantastic reactions to what they've seen so far, it's time to explore the upstairs, where there are four bedrooms. In the older part of the home, a double has dual aspect and exposed beams, and sits next to a smaller double. Then, in the new part of the home, the largest of the guest bedrooms is currently being used as a gym. These are well served by a state-of-the-art family bathroom that even has a built-in entertainment and steam room system. And that leaves the fourth and final bedroom, the master ensuite.
Because it's in the newer part of the house, it's got those lovely big proportions.
Yeah, it's a nice size.
Yeah. Nice Juliet balcony.
And you've got stacks of wardrobe space as well.
I think our bed will fit in here, don't you?
How big is your bed?
It's a tall four-poster.
Okay. There's a great-sized ensuite as well. Why don't we go outside? Because I know this is only half a story for you, really, because the cattery business and the land, that really matters as well, doesn't it?
Yeah, that's a big part of it.
OK, there's a lot to see in this one, so come on.
The interior of this 19th-century stone house seems to really score highly, and that hopefully will be continued outside. There's an attached double garage and a plot of almost 2 acres, including a fully fenced paddock and south-facing landscape gardens, where a summer house and decking overlook a pretty pond. There's an orchard, a greenhouse, and a stable block hooked to power and water, perhaps offering potential for Vicky's cattery ambitions.
This is just what I was thinking about.
It's just the right amount of land, I would say.
Yeah,
it is. And there's some potentially useful buildings.
But I think I need to give this a lot of thought.
OK, so you've seen everything. You know what's coming now. It's time to guess the price. Who's going first?
I'm going to say £825,000.
I think I'll go a little bit less than you, Chris. I'm going to go £795,000.
Sorry, but you're both wrong.
£850,000.
It's bang on budget. Yeah. It's on for £850,000. It is.
Yeah, I can understand that.
Definitely one for consideration.
Is it growing on you a bit?
It is. I think coming outside and seeing the land and the potential for the cattery, I think it really is growing on me.
OK, well, that seems a good point then for me to say, go and have another look. Come and find me when you're ready. Well, listen, when I first saw their faces, when I showed them this property, I wasn't expecting that kind of reaction. I think we might have a slow burner on our hands.
Right at the top end of their budget, this extended 19th century stone property features a hand-built country kitchen, plus three reception rooms. There are four bedrooms, including two with ensuite bathrooms. Plus, the large plot includes a south-facing garden and stables linked up to utilities.
From the outside, I think this property looks really nice. I like the natural stone, and I think there's lots of space around it, which is what we're looking for.
The property is substantial. Lots of rooms, lots of interesting spaces. I think my favourite room was the dining room. But there's lots of potential there, and I think it really challenges us to think about how we would use the internal space in the house.
It has the potential to build the cattery. We really like the outside.
I think we might have given you two something to think about with this one.
I think you have.
Good way to round off the house hunting day, though. Come on. With varied landscapes from brooding moors to rolling dales and low population densities in areas such as Rydale, Yorkshire is a fantastic region for those looking for property with land. Vicky and Chris are no exception when it comes to wanting acreage, but using it to house a cattery is perhaps a little more unusual. A couple of years ago, Julie Guy was in a similar position. It was always her dream to make her living from looking after cats, so she moved to Yorkshire to fulfil it. Today, our house hunters are meeting her to find out just how she went about making her plans a reality.
Hello, welcome.
Hi.
Welcome.
How nice to meet you both.
Nice to meet you too, Julie.
How did you come to start up your cattery business?
Well, this was a dream, really, that we wanted to do for many years. And once the children flew the nest, we saw this, and it was already an established business. It had been here for about 10 years, and we just fell in love with it.
So we're thinking of starting our own cattery. Have you got any advice for us? I mean, was it difficult when you started?
It's such a responsibility. You're looking after someone's beloved cats while they're on holiday, so you want to do it right. It is all day, every day, 7 days a week, but you want your customers knowing that their cats are happy.
And from a business point of view, Julie, how difficult is it?
Well, for me, the licence was already here. So all I had to do was ring the council and explain that we were taking over the business. They then came out and did an inspection. They'll do that every year. It's a spot check, which is good because then they just come out. You don't know them when they're coming out, so you always keep it to that very high standard.
Regulations governing catteries include rules on the minimum area each cat has to sleep and exercise in. At Julie's establishment, whilst the cats are able to see into their neighbour's pen, there is space between them called sneeze gaps, which helps to prevent any infection spreading. Set in 2 acres of gardens outside the market town of Thirsk, the peaceful country surroundings are great for Julie's feline guests, but it also means she's had to work to attract new clients.
You're obviously out here in the country. So what's your advice to us on how we can reach out and find some customers?
I think you need to get out there. You need to advertise all your local vets. It's very much a word of mouth business. They need to trust you. I invite them to come into the cattery, have a look around, spend some time with the cat before they actually leave the cat with me.
One of the ways Julie has enhanced her business is by arranging a weekly visit from local cat groomer Maxine Chaplin.
So, Maxine, who do we have here?
This is Tabitha. Tabitha's one of my quieter and tamer clients. She enjoys being groomed, but I have to say not all cats are as good as Tabitha. Would you like a go at grooming, Vicky?
Yeah, that'd be great.
There we go.
Little darling.
Just give her a moment to settle. Yeah. She seems quite as if she's going to relax for you now. There we are.
Good girl. Do I start at any particular point or...?
Yes, generally when we're doing a full groom, we would start at the back end there and move up a little at a time. It's a nice, firm stroke and always brushing the direction of the coat as you're doing there.
Brushing can help to stop a cat from developing hairballs caused by molting, as well as aid bonding and help the owners keep a close eye on their cat's condition.
So how did you learn to handle other people's cats? Because it must be quite easy handling your own and gaining the confidence with your own cat.
Well, I went on a training course to learn handling and restraint techniques. You do get very feisty cats. So it could be a good idea perhaps to contact your local animal rescue or a Blue Cross cat's home and just ask to go and volunteer and mingle with the cats and get used to handling them, really.
Now that Chris and Vicky have the inside track on the business side of their move, let's see if we can find them a property they think is the cat's whiskers here in the Yorkshire countryside. We're in the historic county of Yorkshire, helping Vicky and Chris, who currently live in Prestbury, Cheshire, move back to the region they both grew up in. We've already seen some fantastic property for their top budget of £850,000, and there's more to come, including a mystery house.
Wow, incredible. We asked for views. Look what you've given us. Yeah.
Plus, I get a lesson in nostalgic Yorkshire baking.
It's a real memory of childhood coming back, of bonfire nights. Yeah. Absolutely brilliant, Chris.
It's day two of our house search here in North Yorkshire, and we ended yesterday on a positive note with a property that challenged Vicky and Chris to think about how they're going to have to strike a balance between finding a house to call home, but also making sure it has the potential to work for their new business idea. Well, we have two new properties to challenge our couple with today. And when it comes to the mystery house, they're going to have to work a little bit harder. But I think it has the potential to offer them everything they need and a whole lot more. We're starting the second day of our house hunt in the small village of Nether Silton. Located on the edge of the North York Moors, in the 19th century, employment in the village was based on agriculture. And at that time, a small chapel of ease was extended to form the current church. Set along quiet country lanes, many of the village houses are built from honey-coloured York stone, as is the local pub. It's a mile and a half from here to the property we've come to view.
Looks nice.
It looks really nice. Is it an old property that's been modernised?
Yeah, it's quite hard to tell, isn't it? So it dates back to the 1800s. It is an old stone house. And then there's been later additions. So one of the later additions was added in the 90s, and it's actually a self-contained annex, which could work as a holiday let.
OK, that sounds interesting.
Oh, very interesting.
Let's explore inside. The news of an annex has certainly piqued their interest in this option. But before investigating that, we're heading through the entrance lobby and hall of the main house into the largest of the reception rooms.
So let's start off in the living room. It's a good size.
Very nice room. It's beautifully kept, beautifully decorated. To have a lounge where you can actually look out onto views is really nice because you spend quite a bit of time in here.
Yeah.
OK, well, that's a good start. I think you're going to like the space on offer in this one as well.
Behind this room is a useful study, along with a cloakroom, whilst across the hall are the remaining ground floor rooms.
So you've got this fantastic sized dining room that leads through to the kitchen. Again, nice and bright and airy.
Yeah, I like this. Very nice. I like this part of the house.
But I thought as well, what this room offers you is the potential that if you did want to remodel this into a really big farmhouse kitchen, you could take that wall down and extend that into the dining room and have a really big space in here as well. So you've got lots of potential to really put your mark on this.
Yeah, it's really nice. Very nice. I like this part of the house.
I can picture this. Lots of friends, visitors, all sitting around. I can see how that would work, yeah.
Off the kitchen, there's also a utility room, and this leads into a double garage which adjoins the annex. This offers a kitchen and living area, a shower room, and the first of the home's four bedrooms. Back upstairs in the main house, we find three more good-sized bedrooms. A guest double has windows to the front of the home and sits next to a further guest bedroom currently used as a twin. These are served by a family bathroom with corner bath and separate shower. And then there's the room that could be Chris and Vicky's.
So this is the master bedroom. It's got a really good sized ensuite. And of course, you get those views when you sat in bed with your cup of tea.
Yeah, smaller than we used to, but it's nice. It's very nice.
It's clearly a very well looked after house.
Well, there's a lot to explore outside with this, and I know that the cattery business is really important to you, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
And I've got something that could just do the trick for that. So let's go and explore that.
A mixed response to the accommodation on offer here, but set behind the annex is a hidden bonus. Here, former stables have been converted to dog kennels, giving plenty of scope for Vicky's planned business.
Oh, wow, this would be great for the cattery.
Yeah, fantastic. But yeah, it's a great start.
Yeah, it's a
tremendous potential.
It's a great space. On the face of it, I think it could work. And I like the idea that it is actually next to the house. Yeah.
Well, I'm glad that it's got potential. So let's go and take a look at the garden and what else is outside.
Well, they asked for land, and this option certainly delivers, with 1.5 acres of paddocks, plus a further 0.5 acre of well-maintained south-facing gardens. There's an open barn, along with the rural views they'd like.
So this is a good spot to settle at the entrance to the paddock. It's very picturesque.
Oh, it's absolutely lovely. There's space here for an orchard, and there's also space for actually quite a large kitchen garden.
You'd certainly be able to grow a lot of things to make your jams and your chutneys from in a space like that, wouldn't you?
We may become industrial.
So we've seen all that this property has to offer. It's time to guess the price. I think it's your turn, isn't it, Vicky?
It's my turn. I'm going to guess at £825,000.
I'm going to say £799.
I think I might have some good news, potentially, for both of you, because it's on the market for £725,000.
Wow.
Oh, that's good.
That is thought-provoking.
Because we would like to put our mark on it. I think we need to go away and have a think about what we could do.
Why don't you head off inside, start taking a look around, let your imaginations run riot, and come and find me when you've seen enough?
Leaving £125,000 in their pocket, this 19th-century property offers them a main home with a kitchen diner and 2 further reception rooms. There are 3 bedrooms in the main house, plus a 1-bedroomed annex. Outside, there's the land they've asked for, as well as an outbuilding for the cattery.
From the outside, this property looks great. Wonderful views, and it just looks like a lovely old Yorkstone cottage. And the outbuildings, really thought-provoking. There's a lot of basic work that's already done there for Vicky to build a cattery.
There's the annex also, which we could use as a holiday cottage. So from that perspective, that would help us bring an income in.
It's got you thinking, this one, hasn't it?
It certainly has.
Well, hold your thoughts, because we've got the mystery house to see.
We're heading close to the tiny hamlet of Yearsley Bank. Located in the Hawardian Hills area of outstanding natural beauty, just under a mile away, the village of Bransby was a medieval centre for ceramics, and the local hall hosts a variety of activities from amateur dramatics to wood carving. But back at the vantage point of Yearsley Bank, our mystery offering enjoys a prime countryside position.
So this is what we've brought you to see. Now, what's happened with this house is the current owners have added a 2-bedroomed extension around 3 years ago. So that's the mystery. It's right. 2 houses in one. Half done, half not.
Very interesting.
Really interesting, yeah. Even in this weather, the view's amazing.
Well, let's go and see what that view looks like from inside in the warm.
Great.
They had said at the outset that they didn't want a modern home, so there is a risk that this property won't be to Chris and Vicky's taste. The main house was built in the 1970s, but we're starting our tour in the new extension, which packs a contemporary punch.
So come on through. I'm going to take you straight down here to the room with a view.
Oh, wow. This is incredible.
Yeah, just what we're looking for.
It's special, isn't it?
Yeah. And the views are amazing.
Off the kitchen, there's also a cloakroom, whilst the upper floor of the extension offers 2 bedrooms. With 4 more in the main house, it's a far cry from the downsize they were planning. There's a small guest room, a family bathroom, as well as the master that's designed to impress.
So come on in.
Oh, this is nice.
Oh, yeah. Wow, incredible. We asked for views, not what you've given us. Yeah.
One thing I wanted to talk to you about was the glass in the window, which is very, very slightly mirrored from the outside. So you don't need curtains in here. Nobody can actually see in to see you.
Amazing.
Yeah.
This is the bit you can live in straight away, move into, not have to do a thing to. And let's go into the older part of the house and see where you can really make your mark on there.
A considerable amount of the accommodation in the main house is ripe for renovation. The ground floor houses the original kitchen, study and reception room. Upstairs, there are four further bedrooms, including one with an ensuite, plus a family bathroom with separate WC.
And here we are in the old part of the house. There you go, Vicky. You can make your mark in here.
This is a good size as well, isn't it?
We've gutted houses before, so doing something like this doesn't scare us at all. And I'm sure we can do lots with this property to really exploit all those things that we've wanted.
I think it's manageable.
And the great thing is, you've got an absolutely gorgeous home to be living in whilst you're doing it. You're not living in the midst of building work, are you?
No.
Wowed by the work that's already been done here and excited by the prospect of a remaining project, a mystery house offers Chris and Vicky the best of both worlds. And there really is a good deal of land with this one. 2 acres around the house include paddocks, plus a part-finished stone garage, and a stable block with power and electricity. But there's more to come. Quite a lot more.
Cast your eyes as far as you can see into the distance, because there's also 30 acres of additional land, along with a 3,000 square foot, completely secure agricultural shed as well. You're stunned, aren't you?
Yeah. Wow.
Now, don't worry.
What do we do with that?
Well, you don't need to do anything with it. That's the beauty of it, because at the moment, the local farmer is using it all, so it's rented out. It's tenanted land at the moment.
Yeah.
Now you know all of that, I'm going to put you on the spot and ask you to guess the price.
I'll say £700,000.
I think it's another £100,000 on top of what Chris has suggested.
OK, so you're saying £800,000.
I'm saying £800,000.
OK. The drinks are most definitely on you tonight, I'm afraid, because Vicky is bang on. It's actually on the market for offers in excess of £800,000.
Yeah, I can understand that.
I really like it. I hope Chris does too.
Chris really likes it. Chris does really like it, yeah.
Well, why don't you go back inside, take another look around, spend some time just thinking about it all. Come and find me when you're ready.
This extended mystery Yorkstone house comes with a spectacular open-plan kitchen and a total of 6 bedrooms, whilst outside there's a staggering 30 acres of land in total, including 2 acres of paddocks and gardens, a stable block, and additional farmland that's currently rented out. It would give them projects both inside and out, and it certainly wouldn't be the downsize they were intending. But it is located in Chris and Vicky's favoured area of the Hawardian Hills.
I think we could make a catchery out of this.
Yeah, I think you could.
And nice views for the cats.
Yeah.
Excellent. I think this property is wonderful. The modern part of the house is spectacular. It's done to a really high standard, and the windows on the back of the kitchen just lend itself to the wonderful views.
The old part of the property obviously needs a lot of work doing to it to bring it up to the standard of the newer part of the property. 2 acres here around the house, which is just ideal and what we've been looking for, and then the additional 28 acres, which is rented out, may well provide us with an interesting income source and opportunities down the line.
I think we've ended with one that's given us a lot to talk about.
Absolutely.
Should we find a nice quiet spot?
Oh, good idea.
That would be lovely. Oh.
The discovery of mineral-rich waters in one corner of Yorkshire drew wealthy visitors to the area to take advantage of its reputed health-giving properties. From the Georgian era, the spa town of Harrogate saw wealth from its booming tourist industry benefit many local businesses. Since the early part of the 20th century, Betty's Tea Room has been attracting visitors through its doors. Here, Yorkshire-inspired bakes from Parkin to Fat Rascals are made, along with other delicacies. Yorkshireman and food historian Peter Breers is well placed to tell me about the tradition of taking tea in the county, as well as the history of the tasty treats that go with it. Peter, being a Lancashire girl, I know how important having a good cup of tea is. And that tradition is very strong here in Yorkshire, isn't it?
Well, it certainly is. In the 17th century, if you took cakes or biscuits, you took it with wine. And then, of course, tea comes along, and tea is incredibly expensive. And so it becomes fashionable for the ladies in places like Harrogate and York to have their tea. And at the end of the tea, they used to actually tot up how much it was and then all clubbed together.
Oh,
even at each other's houses.
The high cost of tea meant only the wealthy in society could afford it. For them, it was a luxurious bridge enjoyed between their midday and evening meals. And to accompany the drink were baked goods, strongly associated with the Yorkshire region. Like Fat Rascals, a type of cake cooked in a peat fire, enriched with dried fruits and meat fats.
If you'd like to help yourself, that is traditional one. That's done to 19th century recipe.
Wow, they're very dense, aren't they?
They're very dense. There's no raising agents at all.
It's definitely an acquired taste.
If you were living on oatmeal porridge and a bit of bacon, that's a luxury.
Peter's authentic 19th century creation comes from handwritten descriptions of the time.
I love the baking direction, which is bake in an oven, not too hot. It's not giving the baker an awful lot to go on there, is it?
And the way you judge the temperature is either your hand or your elbow.
Peter's recipe book is full of historic morsels, but I'm pleased to say the version of Fat Rascal on offer today is not made from the original recipe.
You see why no one, apart from people like me, would do the original Fat Rascal.
I mean, straight away, it's more like, you know, it's a soft cake, isn't it? It's more like a scone. But the flavour of the Betty's, I've got to say, wins yours hands down.
In every way.
Along with serving cakes, there are cooking courses on offer. And today, tutor Chris Taylor is going to show me how he makes another northern favourite, Parkin, one that I'm familiar with from my Lancashire childhood.
My grandma used to bake Parkin with me, and that's the one that I recognise out of the three cakes that are there.
Yeah, that's the more traditional one. That's the one with the darker treacle, the black treacle in there. So it's much more sustaining, much more sort of earthy flavours, as opposed to the honey version. Or the more sort of contemporary version there with the golden treacle and a little bit of black treacle in there as well.
Parkin has its origins in northern England and is typically eaten on bonfire night and throughout the winter months. The contemporary version we're making starts with preparing a toffee mixture.
These are all the sugars and the fats that we're going to melt together.
In a saucepan, we combine golden syrup, black treacle, soft brown sugar, and some salted butter.
Salt's important in baking. It helps to brown things, crisp things, and of course, tempers the sweetness of the sugars that we've got in there as well.
Everything is then stirred together over a medium flame until the sugar dissolves and the butter melts.
Now, this is melting down beautifully.
It is. You just need a little bit more so that butter just becomes part of the syrup, so you can't tell that there's any fat floating on the top.
OK.
Next, we put all the dry ingredients into a large bowl. Plain flour, rolled oats, a pinch of salt, some ground ginger and baking powder.
And then we just want to swish those around with our fingertips.
Then it's time to pour in our melted toffee.
Just pour it on the top.
Stick it all in?
Yeah, just scrape it all into there.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Oh, still smelling fantastic.
A beaten mixture of egg, milk and bicarbonate of soda is added.
All in.
Yep. There we go.
And then use your little scraper and just combine it together, and it's as easy as that to make the batter.
It's such a simple recipe, isn't it? I mean, literally, you know, a young child could do this. It's so fun to do.
Exactly, and it's the kind of recipe I learnt with from my mum. Very quick, easy recipes that don't take too much in the sense of equipment and, you know, and time.
How does that look, Chris?
That looks absolutely wonderful. Ready to go into the oven, and we must be quite quick when we get it into the oven because of the raising agents that are in there and the egg itself. If we don't get it into the oven quick, we'll lose all the bubbles that are being created.
The parking takes around half an hour to bake at 175 degrees Celsius in a fan-assisted oven. But happily for me, Chris has one he made earlier.
Oh, lovely. The important bit. Let's give it a go. It's a real memory of childhood coming back, of bonfire nights.
Yeah.
Absolutely brilliant, Chris.
Lovely.
It's been great taking a trip down memory lane with some real northern baking. But now it's time to see if finding Vicky and Chris their perfect property was a piece of cake and if we got the ingredients right.
Well, that's the end of our house hunt here in North Yorkshire, and I'm confident we've given Vicky and Chris plenty to think about. So let's find out what those thoughts are. So, you two, we've been on quite a journey, not just geographically, but also I think it's given you two plenty to think about, and I'm intrigued.
It certainly has given us lots to think about, but the one that really did it for me was the mystery house.
It kind of blew you away a bit, didn't it,
I think? It did. The views were just the most amazing views.
The house is spectacular, and when it's finished will be even more so, and the land, everything really impressed us.
But I guess lots of questions come with that as well. I mean, not least, you know, there is a lot of work to be done.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of homework to be done. We'll have to get the calculator out and figure out the affordability side of things. But I think we've agreed that we're going to move forward and show signs of interest in that property, yeah.
That's fantastic news.
I think you did a great job for us there.
You've done a fantastic job.
It's been immensely thought-provoking, and I think we're both a little bit excited.
And nervous.
And nervous, I suppose, yeah, yeah. And what's amazing in a way is if you'd asked us to stick a pin in a map as to exactly where we would be, it's probably right on top of where that house is right now.
Well, we wish you lots of luck, and I'm sure that you're going to be very happy here in North Yorkshire, wherever you end up, but I hope it's on that particular pin in the map.
We'll let you know.
It's the end of our time here in North Yorkshire, and I'm delighted that Vicky and Chris have discovered a couple of properties that they could imagine calling home, not just for them, but also for their new cattery business. There are still plenty of questions to be answered, but I hope that we've helped them on their journey to this beautiful county. Join me next time on Escape to the Country. I'm pleased to report that Vicky and Chris did return to the Mystery House, and after deciding it's the one for them, they're currently in negotiations to potentially buy the property. If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.